Thank you. This morning, I've been talking about the value of finding common ground and working together to create a solid public policy. We have a real special treat this morning. I am pleased to now share the stage with someone who has embodied that idea throughout his remarkable career, the Honorable Willie Brown. Mr. Brown is legendary in the political figure in the state, former Speaker of the California Assembly, two-term mayor of San Francisco, and someone who has been at the corner of California politics, government, and civic life. The master of the art of politics, the Honorable Willie Brown. Now, this is not only an honor. I've seen Mr. Brown a couple times give his talks, and they're really, this chatting environment is one of the most enjoyable to be around you, Mr. Brown. Now, I want to make sure this morning I'm addressing you correctly. Did you enjoy being speaker or mayor? More beneficial. And whatever your answer is, that's how I'm going to honorably address you.
You got to know that I struggled to get the speakership. I first got defeated for speaker because of the Democrats in their caucus chose somebody else, Leo McCarthy, who went on for 7 years to run the House on behalf of the Democrats primarily. In 1980, we put together an operation that addressed the rules and the regulations of the House. It is clear the House elects the Speaker, not a caucus. And I had always been one who had really studies the rules, knowing that probably nobody else reads them. And even if I interpret them incorrectly, there'd be no challenge. And so, in that regard, I went out of my way to have the 79 other members know that I wanted to be the Speaker of the House, not of the caucus, and that I'm elected Speaker. I will treat every member, especially those who voted for me, as as real participants in the process of running the state. And I loved it. I got to tell you, I loved it. I had 2 years of Jerry Brown. I had 8 years of George Duke Majan. And I had 5+ years of Pete Wilson, two Republican governors for most of the time that I served, and one Democratic governor who was on his way out when I won. That was a great life. And I apparently so offended voters that they decided to say, enough is enough for you to serve, even though I'd done an incredible job, I thought. They decided something called term limits would be imposed. And you know, it's interesting because at that time I was pretty sharp. I could actually walk. speak without any assistance, and nobody was discussing my age, and it was a fabulous life, and I loved it. But when term limits came along, it was necessary to find something else to do. After I had had almost 30 years, 32, 33 years, of being a legislator, I had not cultivated any alternative exit strategy. And I was heavily indebted, so there was no question that I had to figure out how to keep my job, or a job. And it appeared with San Francisco, there was a mayor's job that appeared to not be really fully occupied. And so I decided to run for mayor. And it was kind of fun because suddenly the 14 plus years of being the speaker, I had established a working relationship with the whole state of California, mm-hmm. literally. And in that regard, there was no title associated, whether it was Democrats or Republicans or independents or non-voters even. It was a great opportunity to link those four together and get my job. And I did. I defeated the incumbent mayor, former police chief. And then it dawned on me, I actually had to do the job. And unlike when I served as speaker, where I could call upon the chair of Ways and Means, I could call upon the chair of Rev and Tax, I could call upon whomever I wished. And I had a multiplicity of folk. I gave chairmanships to the talent, not just because of, and particularly the talent wise enough to make sure I stayed speaker. and so, but I could not do that at the local level. I didn't, I got there and they told me there's some called supervisors. And in fact, they were really annoying. There was an elected city attorney. Are you kidding me? I hire lawyers. It was, everybody was elected. Yeah. I mean, it was incredible. Everybody was elected. So it was a real challenge. Suddenly, I was alone. I was literally blessed with many of my Sacramento staff people relocating to be of assistance. Some actually moved there to help out. And I got to tell you, it was not long before I realized that the local types were nowhere near the talent of the members that I had served with. Mm-hmm. And if I could persuade the members all those years, if I could persuade two governors, if I could persuade people of different parties, I thought maybe I could get the job done. And I gotta tell you, being the CEO of anything is fabulous, but being the CEO of a city, one you can treat as your domain, which I kinda did, and to be there every day to literally start at 6 o'clock in the morning and run till 9 o'clock at night every day. Didn't have to drive a car anyplace. I had 90 motorcycle cops that love making sure that I got to wherever I was supposed to go.
Right.
On time. I didn't have that here. These highway patrol never gave me that kind of service. So suddenly I had a relationship, and I can tell you that I got those guys because when I went to get the endorsement for mayor.
Yeah.
I'm a police chief was the mayor.
Right.
There's no way I'm gonna get the endorsement of these police. They had it at the Fairmount. They had the endorsement day. First of all, what the hell's cops doing at the Fairmount? but they had a when I start to walk in for the endorsement, the whole area was littered with motorcycles for the motorcycle cops.
Uh-huh.
But they were all kinds of motorcycles. There was a Moto Guzzi, there was a BMW. I could not believe what I was looking at. So when I went in, figuring out whatever I say, they're gonna reject it. So let's not talk about anything that I'm gonna do except that which may persuade them. I ask, please raise your hands if you came in on one of those motorcycles out there. And, you know, 70, 80 guys raised their hands. I said, before I tell you about anything else, elect me mayor, and you're gonna get Harleys. I walked out of there with every cop.
Every cop endorsement?
Every cop supporting me. Every single solitary one of them supported me. And it became fun, as a matter of fact. And it was more fun than being here as speaker. So your question is, which would I prefer?
Don't worry, we were gonna get back there.
Okay. Which would I prefer? I really preferred being the CEO, and I now know why Alan lasted 25 years. It's a great job. You run a city.
Yeah.
Particularly if you can figure out how to get past all the other local elected officials that invariably are making very bad decisions. And that's what I did. And so I ended up literally having, it was almost like it was my domain.
Yeah, perfect.
I so preferred because I didn't have to put up with the 79 people that I had to keep playing host to keep my job.
Yeah. So Mr. Mayor, is that safe then to say, Mr. Mayor? I want to open up knowing your views. California has transformed essentially into a one-party state. What are your views on the demise of the Republican Party in California?
It's frankly too bad. Mm-hmm. And I say that because I think the state of California, at the time that George Duke Majum was governor, at the time that Pete Wilson was governor, at the time that David Roberti was pro tem, at the time that Ken Matty was leader on that mm-hmm. side, I went through, I think, five or six on my side leaders, but we were the big five. Mm-hmm. And we did not at any time allow the narrow view of just one political party to prevail in the decisions that were made by us on behalf of the people of the state of California. And that really worked well. After I left, things began to deteriorate in that the term limits said for 6 years, you could be in the legislature. You get elected the first day, the first thing you start thinking about is, what can I do next? I gotta get the hell out of here. No sense in me becoming an expert in water. No sense in me becoming an expert in land use and planning. No sense in me becoming an expert in fracking or any of the other kinds of things that we had to deal with because I'm not gonna be around here long enough, and nor is anybody else gonna be around here long enough. And that probably contributed because suddenly members had to begin for the continuation of their careers starting in about 1994, they really thought they needed to rely upon political party choices. They were no longer able to look to the Big Five to do the budget, and no one knew the Big Five took care of everything that needed to be taken care of, and nobody was blamed, and nobody got credit, or everybody got credit. They really began the horror process of where we are today, and that is we are making our decisions based upon party preference, and that's not people preference for the state of California.
Very good, very good. Last question. You came here in 1951 from Texas as a land of opportunity for you, and clearly you've embraced it and have done an outstanding job for the state and San Francisco. Is California a beacon of opportunity for young people anymore?
Forever. I don't know how California could be perceived any other way. We really are a nation state. Mm-hmm. We're not like, we're certainly not like Texas. We appear to constantly try to address whatever the issue might be. When the Gay Men's Course performed,
right,
and they said it was created in 84 here, started in 84 here in Sacramento, mm-hmm, that was about the same year that a Republican governor named George Duke Majan agreed with the Ways and Means Committee of the California State Legislature, chaired by John Vasconcellos, agreed with the Health Committee, at that time addressing this mysterious disease that was killing people. Mm-hmm. It represented a real threat. George Duke Majan did not ask any questions about which party. He accepted the recommendation that came primarily from those two committees and then ultimately from the rest of us on providing the first research dollars in this country by a government on the question of AIDS, and it was called something else at that time, period. So I got to tell you, that was an example of how matters were dealt with. When Maxine Waters presented the opportunity to address the issue of Nelson Mandela's incarceration, mm-hmm, in Africa, George Duke Majan went with me to the Regency's meeting, mm-hmm, since we both served on that body. And the divestment came out of that effort. Had nothing to do with Democrats or Republicans as political partners. It had to do with what made sense. We were, frankly, really blessed with the idea that what makes sense could be translated into goodness that caused people to want to work, and to do it together, and in some cases, take credit and get elected.
Thank you very much. The Honorable Mayor Willie Brown.